So an important part of Smart City Summit that we've seen is all the cool gizmos and gadgets. Those are getting a lot of attention. You see that you have some cool gizmos and gadgets. Tell us about what we have here and how this impacts smart cities.
Well, thanks, sure. It is pretty exciting to be here and what's seeing what's happening with these smart cities, and the IoT is a dimension of these smart cities or the Internet of Things. But what we have here is the Edgeline family. So it's a family of products and systems, the EL10 or Edgeline 10, the EL20, the EL1000, the EL4000. Each one of them has an express purpose. The smaller ones here are called IoT gateways. That's their name in their product category. And this larger one, the EL1000 and the EL4000, are called converged IoT systems. Now, the converged IoT system is a brand new category of products expressly designed for the IoT. And it's rather exciting because HPE, Hewlett-Packard Enterprise, is the leader in compute technology in the data center and in the cloud. And we are taking that capability and literally shifting it left out to the edge. And the edge is where the things are.
Right.
So the closer these compute capabilities and data acquisition and control capabilities are to the things, the faster we can take action and have real-time response and real-time control.
Right. Are these in the market right now, or are you working with cities to implement and execute on these?
Yes, they're in the market. We have different variations, and we're working with different customers, cities as well as manufacturing, for example, smart grids, education systems, education institutions and education systems that would use this as well as a pretty exciting one with agriculture and crop fields.
Tell me more about that. I think agriculture, IoT, we were just talking to Food and City, and the conversation was, you know, here we are talking about kind of these larger systems, but at the end of the day, it's very citizen-focused, and citizen-focused means we feed ourselves. So how are you working in within the larger system to get to the very narrow endpoint of food on the table?
Well, yeah, of course, a city is focused on the citizens and the health, safety, and satisfaction and the efficiency of the way the city runs. But let's drive out to the suburban environment and the, you know, more of the rural environment, and we get to an agricultural environment. And what would we do there? Well, a lot about agriculture has to do with being able to optimize the food production and being able to optimize it for to get the most out of the smallest space, to get the most out of the least cost. So optimizing both financially as well as the, in the volume and production of the substance or the food that's being created. And what I find rather fascinating is the ability to put sensors on vehicles, off-road agricultural vehicles, that can optimize for us by taking soil samples. For example, we don't want to make what's called a type 1 error, where we don't water something and it dies.
Right.
But a type 2 error is when it's watered and it doesn't need it. It's a waste of water and a waste of time. So that's all about efficiency and optimizing by preventative maintenance and not doing it when it doesn't have to be done, et cetera. Also, connection to weather. Why, you know, water if it's going to rain? And doing this automatically without people involved is a safety factor as well as an efficiency and cost factor.
Perfect. And these systems helped optimize that?
They do. Some of the smaller ones can get mounted on vehicles. And they can be, these can be mounted anywhere, really. They can be mounted on walls, they can be mounted in racks, they can be mounted under a shelf, on a shelf, on top of a windmill, in a street light, in an autonomous vehicle, in an off-road tractor, agricultural tractor as well. And we're seeing, because we have a family to serve all the different applications, we're seeing tremendous interest in this notion of the edge. And what is happening out at the edge, meaning not happening in the cloud, but really out at the edge where the things are, is becoming more and more valuable, again, for that real-time response and that real-time action.
And do you see cities, municipalities, governments, kind of third-party systems, are they excited about the edge too, or is it more the technology community that's driving it and then the public sector has to catch up?
No, I think there's quite a realization as we talk about cities, because it's really not a choice. If you think about the future of autonomous vehicles in a city, let's just pick that one.
Sure.
That's achieved celebrity status today, right?
Yeah,
the driverless car.
It's pretty exciting.
And these all these cars, unlike today where the cars don't communicate with each other, but they communicate up in the cloud, if you will, through usually a, you know, maybe a cell site or a satellite, some type of wireless communication. The cars have to communicate with each other. In other words, they have to be aware of each other. And think about the driver car, the one with the driver, we are aware of other cars. If we see somebody coming too close, we take evasive action, we don't turn into something. That's got to happen between cars. So most definitely they'll be computing at the edge because the car is at the edge. The street is the edge, right?
You could even say that smart cities are at the edge. IoT is moving towards the edge.
At the biggest point. And so are the buildings. You know, they're at the edge. Traffic control, health and safety. Being able to get a real-time response faster than having to send it over an unreliable, many times, satellite link or wireless link is extremely important. And I think all of us, even your viewers, have this week had a cell phone call drop or couldn't get through. So there's a reliability factor that will still remain rather challenging for many years to come, but being able to compute it all. Who likes it better, to stream a movie on their phone or to have it downloaded and play it on their smartphone, if you know what I'm saying, because there's no delay.
Whatever is more instant
and more buffering.
Convenience.
That famous buffering doesn't happen. So that's a good metaphor for this whole idea of at the edge is better in many cases, not all cases, but in many cases.
Yeah. So what do you think is going to be the next big boom, the next big wow that comes out of either IoT or smart cities or the combination of the both?
Well, I love two things in this IoT world. I love the notion of prognostics, to be able to predict something. Who does not want to predict the future? Who am I going to marry? Am I going to be sick? Will I make money? You know, what will I be? Will my kids be prouder if their old man's really a square? To quote the Beach Boys, when I grow up to be a man.
Nice.
Who does not want to predict the future? Yeah. We have, you know, the psychic thing and the cards and all that, crystal ball. I think you would agree. So prognostics is this notion of being able to, you know, diagnose and then prognose and predict the future. And I believe the prediction of traffic patterns in cities, the prediction of high crime areas, the prediction of crowds, the prediction of accidents, the prediction of weather issues will cause many times evasive action to take place, and it'll just be healthier and more satisfying. But also it can convert, what I really like, is converting a surprise outage, for example, into a planned outage. So if you're, you know, going down a road and it's surprisingly cut off, then your plans are disrupted. But if you knew it was going to happen, you could take the evasive action. And that's true for anything from washing machines breaking down to street lights breaking down. And it keeps things in service. And when things are in service, it's less cost and also, you know, higher satisfaction for the citizens.
Yeah. Also that efficiency quotient, right?
Indeed, yeah. And that's driving so many things under the economic conditions that we have today.
Absolutely. I've heard a lot of city officials talk about the fact that they're making investments or already have made investments, and that the efficiencies that they realize through IoT and through smart cities connected technology will actually pay for themselves in a very short period of time.
If we shift from the technology to the financial dimension, getting the financial picture down and the business case and an airtight business case is important to get that return on investment. So in addition to the technology, which is a means to achieve such business case and business value, we have a very strong investment in, we call consulting services and business services, to determine that along with our fellow customers and our fellow clients here at Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. In fact, what we try to do is really make it a two-way. We learn from these people, and I call them inspiration customers. That's the name I call them, because they inspire me to change technology, change our processes. But also it works the other way, because we can think of things too that might not have been thought of by our customer. So we want to make suggestions and contributions that way. And I like to use the smartphone as a metaphor. When the telephone part of that smartphone was invented, the cell phone, there wasn't really a lot of customers demanding a camera be in there. Oh, you got to give me a camera. But once it was presented by the cell phone manufacturers or the smartphone manufacturers, it became ubiquitous now. Who does not have a camera? And then now we can enjoy so many selfies.
Yeah, and videos, which is driving network demand. So then it has this full circle kind of.
Who would have thought it would be your GPS and your music player?
Right.
Some of that is consumer demand, but some of it also supply side.
Right.
You know, the supply side presentation of, if you had this, what would you do? And that dialogue we really appreciate to maximize the outcomes and minimize the cost, minimize the false starts, minimize the failures in these experimental times.
And that's really fun on the consumer side. On the industrial side, that's where it really starts to make a difference.
Well, very frankly, I'm focusing a lot on the industrial side.
That makes
because
sense.
There's a couple of reasons. Now, financially, getting the business case more airtight, as I say. The consumer side is a little bit difficult. It's a lot of value, but it's harder to monetize in many ways. I don't want to overgeneralize. It's like the IoT is like talking about cuisine.
Right.
You can't generalize what's the best food in the world and who's an expert on every food. Right? It's just huge. But you know, I like to say sometimes on the consumer side, for example, with one of those pedometers that measure the number of steps, it's hard to make money on providing information sometimes that you walked more steps than some guy in Belgium. you know, for example. I'm not saying that's unvaluable information. I'm just saying, how do you monetize it? Contrary-wise, when you can prevent a $6 million cost of an outage through diagnostics and what we call machine asset monitoring, or you can get a product out tomorrow. Here's an exciting one I like, if I can share with you.
Sure, please.
It's not quite related to cities, but it's one of my most exciting. The company Airbus creates airplanes, and there are thousands of holes in the airplane that have to be filled with screws or bolts or rivets of some sort. And today, manually, they're done, and it takes tools. And there's over 1,000 adjustments and different types of tools to fill these thousands of holes. Okay, so you picture that. Very, very challenging operation to get these airplanes out to market so the Airbus company can enjoy the revenue and therefore progress as a company. It's very, very simple. Get out the product. So my partner company, National Instruments, has created smart glasses connected to the internet. And all the worker has to do is look at the hole, and it does image recognition, and it goes back into the internet of things or the connectivity, and then the tool can begin to blink on which tool to pick up, just by the worker looking at the hole.
That's a fantastic case study.
And the efficiency there, and then you can take, you can use your imagination, you can have bins with the different bolts in it that blink, so you don't have to, you know, fumble through, well, which one goes here, which one is there. The quality goes up, and then think about if there's a problem, if the bolt is being tightened, and the torque on the wrench is automatically programmed, so the worker doesn't have to fumble with that. But you're tightening it, and all of a sudden it snaps. Well, those of us in the business of building products and manufacturing know that that's a major issue, and the supply chain has to get involved. And if it's manual, well, the bolt snapped. I threw it on the side here. Well, when did it snap? Yesterday. Well, Joe was using. Well, Joe's at lunch now. So trying to track down why this product got defective. But think about it. In this world of the new Internet of Things and manufacturing, that thing snaps, and immediately the time of day, the worker, the date, the part number, the temperature.
Maximizing efficiencies on an entirely different level.
The whole supply chain can be informed, and within seconds, without exaggeration, so, oh, my bolts are snapping over in a plant, you know, in Europe. Is that coming from this? So you can see these efficiencies. There's stories after stories after stories, and we're just at the beginning.
And I love the idea of collaboration between all of those different companies really working to help each other create better products and services.
It's so important in a city, because there's so many subcontractors, there's so many suppliers, there's a lot of emotion with people. So to get a city moving in a direction where it's effective, it's affluent, people want to live there, it wins the best place to live awards at these magazines, is going to take a lot of cooperation among a lot of vendors.
Thank you for being a part of it, and thanks for being the part of it that makes it happen.